Welcome to Accounting with Audra, number 4 in our accounting basics. We will walk through adjusting entries, what they are, and how to journalize them. To understand adjusting entries, it is important to understand accounting's time period concept, which assumes business activities are sliced into small time segments and that financial statements are prepared for specific periods, such as monthly, quarterly, or annually. Financials are a snapshot of a business, with the income statement reflecting the net revenues and expenses for a specific time period, and the balance sheet reflecting a point in time as of the last day of that time period. Companies can choose to use a calendar year beginning on January 1 and ending on December 31st for reporting, or a fiscal year, which includes a 12-month period ending on the last day of within the year. In either instance, companies subject to US GAAP are required to publish financials for each quarter as well as the respective year end. At the date of a financial statement, certain journal entries may be recorded as adjusting entries to properly reflect revenues and expenses in the period to which they relate. Adjusting entries also impact asset and liability accounts as necessary. These adjustments are called deferrals and accruals. Let's start by first understanding accruals. Accruals are expenses a business has incurred but not yet paid. Common types of accruals include things like salary expense, interest expense, or utilities. Remember that time period concept we talked about? If an expense has been incurred by a company and they haven't paid the expense before the end of a reporting period, they must book an adjusting entry to properly reflect the expense in the time period incurred, with a debit to an expense and a credit to a payable, since they owe someone payment in the near future. Someone might inquire as to why companies don't just pay expenses when they occur. The reason is practical. For example, think about a utility bill. In the month of December, you may use a lot of electricity or gas to keep your home warm. The bill for the month of December of $125 doesn't arrive until some point in January after the company has calculated your energy usage. They then provide several weeks for you to timely make payment. The cost for using the energy relates to the month of December and thus should be captured as a December expense, even though you may not pay the utility company until a future date in January next year. This is reflected on December 31st by recording a debit to utility expense and a credit to the utility payable. Then, if you pay the bill, let's say on January 15th, you debit the utility payable to get rid of it and credit cash. This ensures timely recognition of costs and the time period to which they relate. The flip side to accrued expenses is accrued revenue. Accrued revenue occurs when a company has delivered goods or produced services but has not yet received payment for those goods or services. In such an instance, they are due the money and the recipient is liable to pay them. Under US GAAP, a company is required to record the revenue at time of delivery, even if payment is not yet received. This is done by debiting accounts receivable, an asset account, and crediting either sales revenue or services revenue, which hits the income statement. I like to use my neighbor, Will, as a great example. Will mows my lawn every other week during the summer for $25 a mow. Often I pay Will after the job is complete. Will puts a post-it note on my front door to confirm that I owe him $25. He's essentially invoicing me. If Will's business was required to follow US GAAP, Will, on completion of mowing, should record a debit to accounts receivable of $25 and a credit to service revenue of $25. Then when I actually pay Will his $25, he records a debit to cash for $25 and a credit to the accounts receivable to move it off the balance sheet. This ensures that irregardless of when payment is received, revenue is captured in the period earned. A helpful reminder for accruals is revenues and expenses are recorded first and the cash occurs later. Let's now look at deferrals, which result from the cash payment or receipt occurring prior to the recognition of revenue expense. Thinking about my neighbor Will's mowing business again, in June, I decide to prepay Will $100 for 4 future mowings. Will hasn't actually done anything to earn that money yet. If Will were running a business again in accordance with US GAAP, Will would debit cash for the receipt of the $100. Will can't say he earned $100 until he actually performs the service. In order for the journal entry to balance, Will records a credit to deferred revenue. This deferred account is actually a liability that shows financial statement users that Will now is liable to mow my lawn 4 times over the next 2 months. Each time that Will mows the lawn over the following weeks, he reduces a portion of his liability deferred revenue with a debit and records service revenue with a credit. In the end, the liability will be reduced to zero and will be left with $100 of cash on his balance sheet and $100 of revenue on his income statement. Deferred expenses, on the other hand, occur when a company prepays an expense. Expenses cannot occur until something is utilized. For example, you can prepay a utility bill, rent an office building, or purchase office supplies. The prepayment is a decrease in cash, so we credit cash on the date of payment. However, you don't actually incur an expense until you actually use the utility, so water or the air conditioner, or you utilize the building being leased for a period of time, or you use up the office supplies during the workday. Therefore, instead of debiting an expense, a company debits a prepaid or asset account. The asset account is reduced when the expense is incurred. For example, let's say a company needs to lease space to sell its product in a local mall. If the company pays 6 months of the rent for the space up front, the company receives a small discount. As such, the company decides to pay $12,000 on January 1 for the use of a lease space over the next 6 months. The cash payment is a credit to cash of $12,000, and the debit is to prepaid rent. Since the expense of using the space doesn't occur until it's actually used at the end of each of the next 6 months, the company will record rental expense for 1/6 of the $12,000 or $2,000 by debiting rent expense for $2,000 and crediting prepaid rent for $2,000 at the end of each month. One of the most common and complex deferred expenses for businesses relates to depreciation. Depreciation is the expensing related to the purchase of an asset that has an estimated useful life greater than a year. Businesses purchase assets all the time, and in most cases, those assets will benefit future revenues of the business. For example, a university may build or purchase a building for $9.75 million that will serve students for decades. The building supports the generation of tuition over the time. Instead of saying the purchase of the building is an immediate expense of $9.75 million to the university, US GAAP instead requires companies to capitalize the asset and spread the cost of the building over its estimated useful life, in this case, 39 years, so that the expense relates to the revenue it generates. On day one, when the asset is purchased, a company debits the asset for $9.75 million on the financials and credits cash or accounts payable for the purchase. As time passes and the asset is used, the company records a proportion of purchase price through the income statement with a debit to depreciation expense for the calculated amount. In this example, we'll use $9.75 million divided by 39 years, or $250,000. And the company will also credit an account called accumulated depreciation to balance. Accumulated depreciation is a contra account that offsets the historical value of the asset. At the end of the useful life of the asset, what should happen is the asset should be reflected on a company's balance sheet as zero or worthless. Just to note, if an asset is fully depreciated and valued at zero on the balance sheet, it doesn't mean the company cannot continue to use the asset in its business to generate revenue. It just means there's no more cost reflected in the income statement. If you use an asset longer than its US GAAP estimated useful life, then you should theoretically increase profit margin for the company in those later years. In episode 5, I'll further explain the various types of depreciation under US GAAP. To recap, a company should look at its activity on a monthly, quarterly, and annual basis. To the extent adjusting entries are needed to reflect the proper timing of revenue and expenses, as well as the appropriate value of assets and liabilities, the company should record those adjusting entries to ensure their financials are accurate. If you enjoy learning accounting concepts with Audra, please subscribe to receive updates when new videos are posted. As always, if you have recommendations for accounting concepts made easy, please include a post in the comments to this video below.